The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Let us pray. O gracious Creator, when you open your hand, you satisfy the desires of every living thing. Bless the land and waters, and give the world a plentiful harvest. Let your Spirit go forth to renew the face of the earth. As you show us your love and kindness in the bounty of creation, save us from selfish use of your gifts, so that people everywhere may give you thanks. Through Jesus Christ, our Lord.
Amen. Amen.
Thank you.
Amen. A blessed good morning to each and every one of you.
Good morning.
May be a warm welcome to our act of worship here today. Extend a special welcome to those who may be visiting in our midst, as well as to our online congregation worshiping with us via our Facebook page. I take this opportunity now as well to extend a warm welcome to the Reverend Canon Dr. Michael Clark, Principal of Cotterton College, who will be our preacher for today and who led our planning and visioning sessions of the last 2 days. It is indeed a pleasure to have you with us here, Dr. Michael. Today, we celebrate Harvest Thanksgiving. And so as we engage in this act of worship, I invite us to open our hearts to this experience as we seek to be in communion with our God. You crown the year with your bounty. Abundance flows wherever you pass. The desert pastures overflow. The hillsides are wrapped in joy. The meadows are dressed in flocks. The valleys are clothed in wheat. What shouts of joy! What singing! Blessed be God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. Alleluia, alleluia.
Blessed be His kingdom, now and forever. Amen. Alleluia, alleluia.
In the beginning, there was humankind, placed within your garden, made steward, gardener, and caretaker of this place of beauty, given responsibilities and the capacity to enjoy. Yet among the seeds we have sown have been weeds and crops of our own choosing, which have either not brought forth good fruit or have spread and choked the earth. Creator God,
forgive us.
Invite you now to sit or kneel at this time. God gave us new life through Jesus Christ and planted special seeds of forgiveness and love in our hearts. What fruit will we bear in our daily lives? In a moment of quiet, let us listen to and be still with God. What does He say to us this harvest time? We praise and thank our God.
Oh, Lord, that we have
we praise and thank our God.
For earth and oceans, for rain and sun, for food and clothes.
We praise and thank our God.
For the blessings of our life and faith and hope.
We praise and thank our God.
For the Creator who made us.
We praise and thank our God
for our family and friends, for neighbors and co-workers.
We praise and thank our God
for God has blessed us beyond all expectations.
We praise and thank our God.
For all our sins which come upon us, to be shelter to those who confess, to be of service to any in need, to keep company with the unwelcome, to seek peace and make friends of our enemies. Amen.
Let us pray. Lord God, you have enriched us, saved us, loved us. Open our hearts and minds to your will, that we may be free to share everything we have, to give away whatever holds us hostage in spirit, that we may always know that possessions are just that, things lovely to have, but to the end, only good for the good they can do in this world. Keep us always in that work, the work of Christ, in Christ's kingdom, the kingdom of God.
Amen.
God of harvest, gardener supreme, you feed us and equip us. Having provided for us, we look to a different harvest, a fruitfulness of lives in service to you and others. God of harvest, continue to feed us, prune us, harvest us, that our lives might bring glory to you. Amen. The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Let us pray. O God, you have made us co-creators of our destiny. We give thanks for productivity and for advances in many fields, in agriculture, in industry and commerce, and in science and technology. Keep us ever mindful of your power and your love, the origin of all that is, the source of strength and wisdom, harmony and wealth. All things come from you, O God. We give you of your own with praise and thanksgiving, through Jesus Christ, our Lord. Blessed Lord, you caused all holy scriptures to be written for our learning. Grant us so to hear them, read, mark, learn, and inwardly digest them, that we may embrace and ever hold fast the blessed hope of eternal life, which you have given us in our Saviour Jesus Christ, who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, forever and ever.
Reading from the Word of God, written in the book of Deuteronomy, chapter 8, beginning at the first verse. All the commandment which I command you this day, you shall be careful to do, that you may live and multiply, and go in and possess the land which the Lord swore to give to your fathers. And you shall remember all the way which the Lord your God has led you these 40 years in the wilderness, that he might humble you, testing you to know what was in your heart, whether you would keep his commandments or not. And he humbled you and let you hunger and fed you with manna, which you did not know, nor did your fathers know, that he might make you know that man does not live by bread alone, but that man lives by everything that proceeds out of the mouth of the Lord. So you shall keep the commandments of the Lord your God by walking in his ways and by fearing him. For the Lord your God is bringing you into a good land, a land of brooks of water, of fountains and springs, flowing forth in valleys and hills, a land of wheat and barley, of vines and fig trees and pomegranates, a land of olive trees and honey, a land in which you will eat bread without scarcity, in which you will lack nothing, a land whose stones are iron, and out of whose hills you can make copper. And you shall eat and be full, and you shall bless the Lord your God for the good land he has given you. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
A reading from the Word of God, written in the letter of James, chapter 1, beginning at the 17th verse. Every good and perfect gift is from above, coming down from the Father of the heavenly lights, who does not change like shifting shadows. He chose to give us birth through the word of truth, that we might be a kind of first fruits of all he created. Therefore, get rid of all moral filth and the evil that is so prevalent, and humbly accept the word planted in you, which can save you. Do not merely listen to the word and so deceive yourselves. Do what it says. Anyone who listens to the word but does not do what it says is like someone who looks at his face in a mirror and after looking at himself, goes away and immediately forgets what he looks like. But whoever looks intently into the perfect law that gives freedom and continues in it, not forgetting what they have heard, but doing it, they will be blessed in what they do. Those who consider themselves religious and yet do not keep a tight rein on their tongues deceive themselves, and their religion is worthless. Religion that God our Father accepts as pure and faultless is this: to look after orphans and widows in their distress, and to keep oneself from being polluted by the world. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
You will drink, or about your body, what you will wear. Is not life more than food, and the body more than clothing? Look at the birds of the air. They neither sow nor reap nor gather into barns, and yet your heavenly Father feeds them. Are you not of more value than they? And can any of you, by worrying, add a single hour to your span of life? Why do you worry about clothing? Consider the lilies of the field, how they grow. They neither toil nor spin, yet I tell you, even Solomon in all his glory was not clothed like one of these. But if God so clothes the grass of the field, which is alive today and tomorrow is thrown into the oven, will he not much more clothe you, you of little faith? Therefore, do not worry, saying, what will I, what will we eat? Or what will we drink? Or what will we wear? For it is the Gentiles who strive for all these things. And indeed, your heavenly Father knows that you need all these things. But strive first for the kingdom of God and his righteousness, and all these things will be given to you as well. This is the gospel of Christ.
Praise to Christ, our
Son and Holy Spirit. Amen. First, let me say it's a joy to be with you this weekend, and I've been amazed. The last time I was here was about 18 years ago. Yes, we're getting old.
Yeah.
But it was amazing to see the development that has taken place over that period. It's wonderful, and I continue to uplift you as a community in prayer. When I came here, it was just after Ivan, and I was very aware of all that was taking place at the time. Let me thank my brother in Christ for his invitation to be with you this weekend and to share with the lovely group on Friday evening and yesterday as we looked at the rediscovery of worship and mission. Every good and perfect gift is from above, coming down from the Father of the heavenly lights, who does not change like shifting shadows. Every good and perfect gift is from above. As I speak to you within the context of the growth and development of even your islands today, as we can look back at the years gone by and see the challenges that you would have faced. As you look at where you are today and all that is taking place in this island and region, and we are able to give God thanks for God's blessings and God's mercies, one of the challenges we have as human beings is remembering. And when we look at the Old Testament, for example, we see that there is this constant invitation through the various books of the Old Testament, inviting the people of Israel to remember. To remember where you've come from. To remember that it was God and God alone, in every moment, in every situation. That was even God when you were in a place of desertion, when you didn't want to be with God, when you were going after other gods. It was still God who brought you back, who brought you through, who guided you through that time. And so, as we gather this morning for this Harvest Thanksgiving, it is yet another opportunity for us to consciously reflect on who we are, to consciously reflect on all that we have received, all that we have gained through the years as individual and as community, and to be able to look at ourselves and recognize the hand of God working through us time and again, bring about God's purpose. Today we gather as the people of God, we gather as a faith community, and we gather to say we're going to give God thanks for the harvest of the land and the seed. And as we do that, there is this important requirement that we don't only look at what God has done for us through the harvest of the land and the sea, but what has God done through me? Am I not God's fruit for the world? Am I not God's planting? Am I not here only by the grace of God? And if I am here by the grace of God, then it is through me that God seeks to work in this world. But the way that God engages us is that there must be a consciousness about it. There must be a sense in which I am aware. In order for those blessings to multiply, I must be aware. And this is why constantly within the Old Testament, there was this constant reminder to the people of God who they are in God and what God has done for them, in order that they may recognize that they come out of that source, that one true source. We've all come out from that one true source. And we are all gifted to the world. One of the challenges that we have, and I was reflecting with this with my diploma course students yesterday, when we were looking at the lives of some of the saints. One of the challenges we have oftentimes is that we look at the lives of the saints and we are awed by their lives. And we lift them up and we call them saint this and saint that, and we say that they were holy persons. But oftentimes, in our doing that, we belittle ourselves and we feel that we are not in any way close to where they were. And we make the error of not recognizing that all they were was that they were there to help us recognize what is possible in this human vessel. What is possible in this human vessel, when this human vessel comes to understand that everything comes from God. So their lives are but examples of what is possible. Their lives are not super lives for us to worship or adore them and forget about our own journey. Each one of us is writing scripture every day. Each one of us is penning the scriptures every day. The same way we will read about the saints and their lives, the same way we must read about our lives. The same way the world will uplift those who through history have done great things in the world as a whole, should we not each believe in testimonies for history to record about how this people of God, in their understanding of God, in their journey with God, have left this testimony of how God works in the world? how God works in individuals. Have we no saints? Or have we looked at the term saint and made it such an unattainable state so that we don't even think of ourselves as the planting of God? Yes, I'm going to make you do it. Say, I am the planting of God. What does that mean? What does that mean? Just let that sink in. What does that mean? How does that affect how I see myself? One of the things that we have inherited through the years is an understanding of humanity that is not very productive. We've bought into the concept of original sin. And oftentimes we speak of ourselves as miserable wretches, miserable sinners, wretches. Well, when you use that kind of language, you can't see yourself as the planting of God. When you pour that kind of enmity onto yourself, you can't see yourself as the blessed that you are. A modern thinker, Matthew Fox, speaks of an original blessing as opposed to original sin. To understand ourselves as being a light sent into the world, being a seed planted by God. God planted each one of us. We too can speak of our own incarnation, becoming flesh. It's not unique to Jesus. It is about all of us, because we are spirit having this physical experience. We are all incarnated. We are all of spirit. And there's only one spirit, and that's God. It is this thinking that shapes our understanding of ourselves, and then it shapes our response. It shapes how we worship. Because if we have this sense that we are the planting of God, whenever we gather for worship, whether it is here together or individually, what we're seeking to do is to come back to source. We are oftentimes reminded that God is not somewhere far off. God is within us. And the invitation constantly is to come home. Come home into that sacred space. We hear even Jesus speaking of it at times when he reminds us that when you pray, go into your, yes, that. Go into your closet. And where is that? It's not any physical place outside here. It is within. So there's the invitation constantly to do the inward journey. But oftentimes, even as people of faith, we are more concerned with the external journey. But the external journey withers and dies. The internal journey is eternal. We spend so much time focusing on that which decays because we can't see that which is eternal. But it is our faith now that speaks about that which is eternal. So if we can't focus on that which is eternal, it offers a testimony that our faith is null and void. If our concern is primarily with our external world, because we can't really see the internal dimension, then it testifies that that which we say with our mouths, we do not really believe in our hearts. And it is about what we believe in our hearts. Because it is the heart that is the gateway to the divine. It is the heart, because the divine, as we shared on Friday evening, is love. And it's not something that we do, it is something that we are. I am love. I am love because I am the planting of God, and God is love. The Gilead seed, I call it Aki, you don't call it Gilead. The Gilead seed can only produce a Gilead tree. God's planting can only produce the offspring of God. We must not be so focused on the visual that we see around us. And here, Father's there, this gentleman is there. The separate. We can see ourselves individually as we look out on the world. But if we practice how to look in on our world, we begin to see differently, and we see the oneness of God. And it is in that perceiving of the oneness of God that we go into mission. Because when we go into mission as the individual helping the other individual, there is that likelihood that at times we begin to perceive ourselves as more than. But when we do the inner journey and we go in and we perceive ourselves as one with the divine, then as that leads us into mission, into work, we do so from a place of understanding that I am serving the one. I am serving the one. I am in the service of the one, and there's only one of us in the room. Because we are all within the divine. Everything comes from God. Everything comes from God. And if we, the people of faith, are able to personalize this and allow it to go deep within us, then we are of little help to the world. Because it is not what we say, but it is the journey we walk, the life we live. And it's not about perfection, because we are imperfect beings living in an imperfect world. And the whole purpose of this imperfection is that we will learn to appreciate perfection. Because, as we would always say, if there was no sharp person, then you wouldn't know what a tall person was. If God was God alone, and God was God within God's self, and there was nothing else, then God would have no experience of God's self. But through creation, God is able to experience. And so, within the context of a perfect God, there is this imperfect world that comes to recognize what a perfect God is. So our task is not to be perfect in an imperfect world, because there's an impossibility here. But our task is to recognize the perfection of God and desire to be at one with that. And by the grace of God, God draws us to God's self. Thank you. day by day. And so it is the orientation of our lives that is important. It is how I perceive myself, how I must constantly remind myself of whose I am, and not be so big-headed, as it were, to think that I've gotten here on my own strength, but to consciously understand myself as the planting of God, in order that I may desire to bear fruit in this world that is God's fruit. And the degree to which I bear fruit, again, is not my doing. Some 30, some 60, some 100-fold. It is God's work, working out in us His will and His way. May God grant us the desire to know ourselves fully as the planting of God. For in doing so, we remind ourselves that every perfect gift is from above. Every perfect gift. And so, in the closing words of the gospel for this morning, we are reminded, strive for the kingdom of God and His righteousness, and everything else flows out from that. Amen.
Amen.
Let us now stand. And with many voices but one heart, let us reaffirm our faith as we say the words of the Nicene Creed. We believe in one God,
the Father, the Almighty, Maker of heaven and earth, of all.
that is seen or unseen. We believe in one Lord, Jesus Christ, the only Son of God, eternally begotten of the Father, God, light from light, true God from true God, begotten from not made, one in being with the Father. Through him all things were made. For us and for our salvation, he came down from heaven. By the power of the Holy Spirit, he was born of the Virgin Mary and became man. For our sake, he was crucified under Pontius Pilate. He suffered, died, and was buried. On the third day, he rose again from the tomb of the scriptures. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again in glory to judge the living and the dead, and his kingdom will have no end. We believe in the Holy Spirit, the Lord, the giver of life, who proceeds from the Father. With the Father and the Son, he is worshipped and glorified. He has spoken through the prophets. We believe in one holy Catholic and Apostolic Church. We acknowledge one baptism for the forgiveness of sins. We look for the resurrection of the dead and the life of the world to come. Amen.
And kneel and sit for intercessory prayers.
Let us pray to God. The Lord of the harvest in all things material and spiritual. As you have blessed the church with abundant grace, keep her faithful in the offering of your word and sacrament, knowing that all things come from you and return to you. Send out your laborers to gather the harvest of the world, that all may know the riches of your love. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
We pray for all who work that others may be fed. For those who bring in the harvest of the land and the sea, we pray for those employed in processing and transport of food. Grant a more just distribution of the goods of the world. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
Give to us, our families and friends, grateful hearts for all your bounty and a concern for the needs of others. Bless those who work to bring meals to the poor and infirm in this community. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
We pray for all who are hungry and undernourished. We pray especially for the children whose health is damaged by lack of food. Bless those who work for the relief of famine. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
We give thanks for the departed who have been gathered into your care. Grant them the joy of faith brought to fruition in your heavenly kingdom. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
We offer our prayers, desiring to be faithful laborers for the harvest of Christ's kingdom. Amen.
As we continue in this time of prayer, invite us to bring to mind and offer prayers for those who are experiencing the realities of war in this world. Those in the Ukraine. Those in Israel and Palestine. Those in the other parts of our world where there's unrest. But because it is not readily seen on our television screens, it is easy to forget. Let us pray for peace in our world, in our recognition of our oneness with God, our oneness with each other. And let us pray that this recognition, this understanding of our oneness with each other and with our God would help to bring peace in our world. Lord, in your mercy, invite us to open our eyes at this point, as I invite the Men's Fellowship to help us in summing up our prayers of intercession as they render a song that says to us, reminds us, on Christ, the solid rock, I stand. Thank you. act of penitence. Holy Scripture reminds us that if we say we have no sin, we deceive ourselves and the truth is not in us. If we confess our sins, God is faithful and just and will forgive our sins and cleanse us from all unrighteousness. Let us therefore confess our sins. Most merciful God, we confess that we have sinned against you in thought, word, and deed,
by what we have done, and by what we have left undone. We have not loved you with our whole hearts. We have not loved our neighbors as ourselves. We have not loved ourselves as we ought. We are truly sorry,
and we humbly repent. For the sake of your Son, Jesus Christ,
have mercy on us and forgive us, that we may delight in your will and walk in your ways, to the glory of your name. Amen.
Almighty God, have mercy on you, pardon and deliver you from all your sins, confirm and strengthen you in all goodness, and keep you in life eternal, through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. Please stand. We are the body of Christ. By the one Spirit, we were all baptized into one body, and have all been made to drink of the one Spirit.
Let us then pursue the things that make for peace, and build up a common life.
The peace of the Lord be always with you.
And also with you.
Please be seated. I now invite the choir to stand and render the anthem in power of God.
Thank you.
prayer after the presentation of the offering. Father, Lord of all creation, in your love, you have made us for yourself. When we turned away, you did not reject us, but came to meet us in your Son.
You embrace us as your children, and welcome us to sit and eat with you.
We bring a harvest of flowers. Consider lilies of the field, how they grow. They toil not, neither do they spin. Yet I say to you that even Solomon in all his glory was not arrayed like one of these. O Lord, how manifold are your works.
The earth is full of your riches.
We bring the harvest of fruits and vegetables, pears, yams, bananas, oranges, pineapples, other produce of the good earth, food for all of your creatures.
You open your hands and fill all things with your abundance.
You bring the harvest of the skill in preserving the gifts from the earth, so that all may eat and be satisfied.
Thanks be to God.
We bring the various products of earth and sea, made for our use by the skill of human hands and the aid of machinery and craftsmanship.
O Lord, how excellent is your name in all the world.
We bring the harvest of money, sign of toil and labor. It is the Lord alone who gives the increase.
O Lord, how excellent is your name in all the world.
We bring the bread and wine, the signs of work and social life. These our Lord took on the night on which he was betrayed, and he blessed them, and they became the sign of his perfect offering for us and all humankind. By these we offer ourselves in union with his once for all sacrifice with thanksgiving.
Receive, O Lord, we beseech you, with these gifts, accept in them the sacrifice of ourselves. And all your mercies, O perfect Son, that we may be in life and death, an offering to you forever. Through Jesus Christ, our Lord and Savior, who lives and reigns with you, O Father and the Holy Spirit, one God, forever and ever. Amen.
The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Lift up your hearts.
We lift them up to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God. Always and everywhere to give you thanks, Father Almighty, everlasting God, through Jesus Christ our Lord, the Word active in creation, who dwelleth among us himself, rejoice in the beauty of the earth, in giving thanks to you for the fruits of harvest and the fishes of the sea, and through his own work, hallowing all human service. Therefore we praise you, joining our voices with angels and archangels, and with all the company of heaven, who forever sing this hymn to proclaim the glory of your name.
Thank you.
Eucharistic prayer. Holy and gracious Father, all creation rightly gives you praise. All life, all holiness comes from you, through your Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord, whom you sent to share our human nature, to live and die as one of us, to reconcile us to you, the God and Father of all. We therefore bring you these gifts, and we ask you to make them holy by the power of your Spirit, that they may become the body and blood of your Son, our Savior Jesus Christ, who offered himself in obedience to your will, the perfect sacrifice for all humankind. On the night he was betrayed, he took bread. And when he had given thanks to you, he broke it and gave it to his disciples and said, "Take this and eat it. This is my body, which is given for you. Do this for the remembrance of me." After supper, he took the cup of wine, and when he had given thanks, he gave it to them and said, "Drink this, all of you. This is my blood of the new covenant, which is shed for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. You do this whenever you drink it for the remembrance of me." Son endured for our salvation, his glorious resurrection and ascension, his continual intercession for us in heaven, and looking for his coming again in glory, we offer you in thanksgiving this holy and life-giving sacrifice. Look with favor on your church's offering, and grant that we who eat and drink these holy gifts may be filled with your Holy Spirit and become one body in Christ, and serve you in unity, constancy, and peace. May he make us a perpetual offering to you, and enable us in communion with Blessed Mary and the whole company of heaven to share in the inheritance of your saints. With him, and in him, and through him, by the power of the Holy Spirit, we worship you, Father Almighty, with all who stand before you in earth and heaven, in songs of everlasting praise.
Our Father, who art in heaven, holy, holy, holy be thy name.
break this bread, to share in the body of Christ.
We are many, we are one body, because we all share. Thank you.
Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Let us pray. Almighty God, we bring unto you the young people of our church. We bring to you the young people of this community, of these Cayman Islands. We pray that no matter how young they may be, they would feel your love. And as they make this journey, they would always seek to love you in all that they do. May their age never be seen as a stumbling block. May we, as the adults, Lord, know that you are calling all of us, even our youth, to do great things in this world. And so give us, O Lord, the strength to encourage them as you use them. I bring to you, Lord, all their cares, their concerns, and we lay them before you, seeking your continued blessings, grace, and glory. Through Jesus Christ we pray. Amen. The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Let us pray. Eternal God and Heavenly Father,
we thank you for feeding us with the body and blood of your Son, Jesus Christ. Send us now into the world in peace, and grant us strength and courage to love and serve you, and all persons in you, with gladness and singleness of heart,
through your Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen. May the peace of God, which surpasses all understanding, keep your hearts and minds in the knowledge and love of God and of his Son, Jesus Christ. And the blessing of God Almighty, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit be with you and remain with you this day and forevermore. Invite us to join with our brothers and sisters in prayer, praying for them, praying with them as they celebrate their birthdays, as they celebrate anniversaries, wedding anniversary, or any other anniversary or special moment of time in their life. If you are indeed present here this morning and you are celebrating, or you celebrated recently but you were not here with us, I invite you to come forward as we uplift you in prayer. their days increase. We ask you to bless and to guide them wherever they may be. Strengthen them when they stand. Comfort them when they are discouraged or they are sorrowful. Raise them up if they fall. And in their hearts, in the peace of God, which surpasses all understanding, abide with them all the days of their lives, through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen.
Good morning, beautiful people.
Good morning.
It is wonderful to see you all and to have you all worshiping with us today. And a wonderful good morning to those who may still be worshiping with us via our Facebook page. Father, having welcomed Reverend Canon Dr. Michael at the top of the service, who I will be calling Father Michael, hopefully going forward, if he doesn't mind. In addition, we welcome all those other visitors, all visitors who may be worshiping with us today. It's good to have you with us. And so we extend a special thanks to Father Michael for facilitating our planning and visioning meeting over the weekend, and also for preaching at this morning's service. We wish you a safe return to your island home of Barbados. And I'm sure you will all join me in thanking Father Michael for his encouraging reminder this morning as to whose we are. Father Michael has this uncanny ability to bring things back to basics, but yet be very deep at the same time. Yes, and we have been blessed for sure for having him with us. So thank you for energizing us this morning and for the past few days. Thank you. Okay, thanks also, before we go into the rest of the notices, to our men's fellowship this morning who are dressed in the red and black. Thank you so much for ministering to us in song this morning. It was wonderful. And thanks also to our chancel choir for their beautiful anthem, led as ever, as ably, by Brother Linda. Thank you. Okay, and moving into the rest of our notices, our midweek service continues this Wednesday at 10 a.m., and so all are invited. And the third of our six-session series, The Unnamed Women in the Bible, continues this Thursday, the 23rd of November at 6:30 p.m. That's this coming Thursday, the 23rd at 6:30 p.m. The third in our six-series session. Interested persons are invited to join via Zoom. The meeting ID and passcode are projected. And of course, our Zumba fitness sessions continue. You can feel free to eat heartily at the brunch after the service today, because you'll be working it off, I'm sure, as we get fit together every first and third Thursday at 6:30 p.m. in the church hall, led by our instructor, Doris Castro. Classes are free. The next session is next Thursday, the 7th of December. Next Thursday, the 7th of December.
Actually, next Thursday is the 30th of November. So it will be still be the 7th of December, but not next Thursday.
Our next session will be on Thursday, the 7th of December. Okay. And we join with our friends from the Republic of Barbados as they celebrate their independence. And the community of Barbados will join us right here at St. George's next Sunday, the 27th of November.
Let me just jump in there. So next Sunday, the 26th. Well, that's not where I'm jumping. That's actually not where I'm jumping. So next Sunday, in Bartoli communities in the Cayman Islands will be joining us in worship, but it says 4 o'clock, not 4 o'clock, at our 9 o'clock service. They'll be joining us for our Sunday morning service. Okay. So they'll be joining us in worship at our 9 o'clock service.
Okay. All right, and as we move towards the first Sunday of Advent, we have a couple of important reminders for you. The first is that the first Sunday of Advent will see the return of the Common Cup. The Common Cup will be returned in our diocese. And we look forward to that. And of course, as you know, baptism as the gateway to Holy Communion, that also returns on the first Sunday of Advent. From that Sunday, we will be returning to the practice of baptism being the gateway to Holy Communion. Okay, and next Sunday, the 26th of... November is the Feast of Christ the King, and we will be having a service of Evensong, solemn Evensong at 5 p.m., and this will be followed by a musical presentation. So do come on, all are invited, and please do bring along a friend. That should be wonderful. Next Sunday, the 26th of November. All right, and so as we move into December and the season of Advent and Christmas, we have a number of special services that will be taking place. Okay, so please note that the service of 9 lessons and carols will be held on Sunday the 10th of December at 6 p.m. All are invited to come out and invite a friend. And Blue Christmas will be held on Wednesday, the 20th of December at 6 p.m. As you may know, Blue Christmas is a special worship experience for persons dealing with loss and grief during the season of Christmas. And our Midnight Mass will be held on Sunday, the 24th of December at 11:45 p.m. Sunday, the 24th at 11:45 p.m. Our Christmas morning service will be held on Monday, the 25th of December at 8 a.m. There will be one service on Monday, the 25th of December at 8 a.m. And our Watch Night service and Feast of the Holy Name will be held on Sunday, the 31st of December at 11 p.m. That's Sunday, the 31st, the last day of this year at 11 p.m. So make note, we look forward to seeing you all. And it's that time of year again when the annual reports for our annual congregational meeting are being requested. All groups are asked to submit their reports by Thursday, the 21st of December, so that we can compile them for the annual congregational meeting in January. So you have more than a month notice. And so, of course, your reports will be in on time. Please do email those reports to secretary@stgeorgecayman.com. Please join us this morning, guilt-free, for our Harvest Thanksgiving brunch that will take place immediately after the service. We look forward to seeing you. Okay, unless there are any other notices, it just remains for me to wish you a wonderful day. See you all in a bit.
Thank you.
The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
My brothers and sisters in Christ, let us now go in peace to love and serve the Lord.
In the name of Christ.
Amen. Be blessed, enjoyable, safe, reflective day and week to everyone.
Amen.